This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truth in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie. With such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord, recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello, this is Jörg Lismer once again from YouTube channel Joggler66 with another recording of Hour of the Truth. We have today, Thursday, the 14th of January 2016. And even though, as you know, I made a little recording yesterday on my own, reading an understandable history of the Bible, the next part of the book, I'm going to make another broadcast today because I have with me my brother in Christ from the United States of America over there, Tom Fress from Inquisition Update, who I warmly welcome to the broadcast. Hello, Tom. How are you doing?
Work, and good day to your listeners, and I'm very blessed to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, you're welcome. This broadcast wouldn't here without you. So I'm very much enjoying having another fellowship with you, and let's catch up a little bit about the things that happened since the last time that we've met. On Hour of the Truth, we had a wonderful conversation where you explained everything that I asked you about the readings that you did on the Global Vatican, how you came to that book, what you've learned from it, and the implications and everything that you've done before and afterwards on that. And we kindly put that to rest, the Global Vatican, and because we put that to rest, of course, you are busy with a new project that you have started some weeks ago now, a reading on Inquisition Update daily on First Amendment Radio. And, well, the interesting thing is the book that you are reading now goes back to the stuff that you've done before, because we said the Global Vatican was kind of a special book because it is, first of all, written from a Knight of Malta. It's a very, very modern book, and it is, of course, a book written from a Catholic perspective, and you only done reading before online, at least, in Inquisition Update, from old Protestant writers. And yes, after the Global Vatican, you decided to do a work on reading a work from James Edgen Wylie called Rome and Civil Liberty, which should better be called Rome or Civil Liberty, or instead of Civil Liberty, whatever you want to call it. And I think this is quite an interesting match that you can read that book right after Global Vatican. So I just wanted to ask you, and that you can tell our listeners, Tom, how did you come to read that book, and what are your findings now that you've started that, and in relation to the reading that you did before, the Global Vatican?
Yes. Well, I'll briefly explain for some of your listeners that may not have heard our first broadcast about Francis Rooney's book, The Global Vatican. Francis Rooney was a Knight of Malta, as you said, and he was also an ambassador of the United States government to the Holy See, as they call it. And his book, literally, without going into any specific detail or anything, just briefly, the book constitutes, in its totality, it constitutes a boast that the Vatican controls both foreign and domestic policy for the United States, and not just the United States, but for the United Nations and all the countries of the world. And it's a startling reality. I mean, we've known this for a long time, but I was startled to find that a Roman Catholic would reveal such truth. And it just goes to show how far advanced their control of the country is. They no longer fear to admit, not only to admit, but to boast that they control the government of the country. And they control the United Nations. And through concordats and diplomatic relations with other nations, they have a great deal of influence in all the governments of the world. And seeing how, as startling as that information is, it fell into my hands in another book along the same lines. And a book written in the 1860s by the Protestant historian James Aitken Wylie, entitled Rome and Civil Liberty. And the brief outline of that book is that England, prior to this time, was Protestant. And because of repeated attempts of the papacy to take over the government, we'll name just a few, the gunpowder plot of 1605, the Spanish Armada, and the Babington plot, and other assassination attempts against the Protestant crown and Parliament of Great Britain, Protestant Great Britain, just as a matter of self-preservation, had to close down or suppress Roman Catholicism and kick the Jesuits out of the country, and to renounce popery and to embrace Christ and the Bible, and to establish a Protestant government that would protect the citizens of Great Britain from the tyranny of the popes, and so that they could write their own laws protecting their Protestant rights. They could establish their own legislature called the Parliament, and enforce Protestant liberty and make Protestant law to govern the country. Well, that first rebellion against Rome came at the time of Henry VIII, and we won't go into detail about that. Your listeners can research what befell Henry VIII, but...
Yeah, sorry to interrupt you here, Tom, but this is a very, very important thing that you are just mentioning here. You know, people only know Henry VIII because he was married a few times and because he got one of his wives beheaded and all that stuff. The people do not know that actually the Protestant history of this world started with Henry VIII, that he is responsible for taking away the power of Rome, that Rome had in the years before that over Great Britain, as it has over, or as it has had over a whole Europe with the Holy Roman Empire.
Yes.
The story of Henry VIII is something that you maybe assume a lot of people know, but that I am quite sure most people don't have any idea what Henry VIII was actually all about. And without Henry VIII, how outrageous he may have been on different things, without him there would have never been the Protestant government that England had for almost 300 years at that time.
Well, so, yes, go ahead.
Yes, so I just want to say to our listeners, then please go a little bit and do a little bit study what Henry VIII actually started, because from Henry VIII flew forth not only Bloody Mary, which is more than just a cocktail, as some Protestants maybe still know, but also the reign of Queen Elizabeth I, one of the, in my opinion at least, you can correct me on that if you don't agree, but in my opinion, a complete 100% Protestant queen, one of the greatest emperors or reigners, rulers the United Kingdom has had in history, and leads up to James I, whom we are thankful for having surviving the gunpowder plot in 1605. Thanks to James I, we hold today in our hand the Bible, the King James Bible of 1611. So without Henry VIII, that's the point that I want to make a little bit for our listeners to understand, we wouldn't be able to hold God's preserved word in English in our hands today, the 1611 King James Bible, which is the authority for this broadcast, is the authority for everything that you and I say here, you on Inquisition Update, I on Hour of the Truth and on Juggler 66, because this is the God-given authority of our conscience. And we wouldn't have that without Henry VIII. And I think there are a lot of people who do not understand these historical implications. So that's why I just wanted to stop you there and just say, don't go too fast over that, you know?
Yeah.
But please
continue. Well, I credit, some people credit Henry VIII for being, you know, really the progenitor of Protestantism in Great Britain. I think that's a little nearsighted. I don't want to, you know, there's a great controversy that's been raging for centuries over what role Henry VIII played. But from my point of view, the Protestant Reformation really began in England with William Tyndale. And he was a translator of the scriptures into the English language. That's how the scriptures were first read in England. And Protestantism was, look, the Englanders were reading the Tyndale Bible and discovering for themselves, like all the Protestants eventually did, that the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist. The Bible speaks of the papacy when it talks of the man of sin, the little horn of Daniel, the son of perdition, and the Antichrist. And that was became the literal, one of the literal foundations of the Protestant Reformation. Now Henry VIII was Roman Catholic.
He surely was. And let's not forget, Tom, Wycliffe.
Yes,
Wycliffe was even before Tyndale, and he brought the first translation, and he translated from the Romish Bible, so from the Latin Bible, into English, because he didn't have the Textus Receptus, but he was the first one who made for the common people in England the Bible, the Word of God, accessible.
Yes. Well, it might be better off to tell the people, many people don't realize this, that during the Dark Ages, when the Pope controlled the kings of the earth in Europe, the Bible was forbidden to be read by the people. And it was only found in Latin, and the common people couldn't read anyway, much less read Latin. And so there was a need for those who wished to worship God in spirit and truth to have the Bible in their hands in the language that they could speak, the language that they could read and understand. And so there were attempts to translate the scriptures into the language of the common people for a long time, which the papacy outlawed, literally burning at the stake those who were caught translating the scriptures into the language of the people. The Bible was a forbidden book. And it was locked up in the among the priests. And, of course, when the people didn't have the true word of God before them, the priests could preach any religion they wanted to. And, of course, when the Bible began to be read by the people, then Protestantism took root. The protest against the papacy. That's what Protestantism is. The protest against the Antichrist. Now, back to Henry VIII. Henry VIII was a Roman Catholic king in a growingly Protestant country. The translation of the Bible in English had been let loose upon the country, and people were coming to the same conclusion that all Protestants came to, that the yoke of tyranny spoken of in the Bible, Revelation chapter 17 and other places, spoke of none other than the papacy. Now, Henry VIII, being a Roman Catholic king, finally came to some controversy over his marriage. He wanted an annulment or a divorce from his wife, since she bore him no heirs, and the papacy wouldn't grant one. And so Henry VIII rebelled against the papacy, and he put away his wife, and he married another. And he was so furious with the papacy that he overthrew the church, the Roman Catholic Church, and adopted Protestantism. Now, Protestantism suited his fancy because he wanted to be done with the papacy once and for all. And so did Protestantism. Now, whether you consider Henry VIII a Protestant or a Catholic, I don't intend to wrestle with anyone over, but the fact of the matter is God opened the door for the truth in England, and he used the King of England, Henry VIII, to do it, and the Protestant translators, the Protestant reformers. And so Henry VIII allowed Protestantism to take over the Church of England and booted the priests out, booted the Jesuits out, and England, for the first time, became Christian, truly Christian. And so the papacy, ever since this time, has tried to recapture England and make it Catholic, under various claims, first of all being the donation of Constantine and the pseudo-Isidorian decretals, and the idea that the papacy is somehow the vicar or the replacement of Christ on earth, and that he should rule the world, the entire world, in Christ's absence, as his vicar, as his representative, his replacement on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of his objectives was not only to control all the governments of Europe, but to regain England, which had fallen to what the papacy regarded as heresy.
Yeah, can I intervene here just a second?
Yeah, certainly. Mm-hmm.
As far as I remember, William Tyndale was burned at the stake in 1536. Mm-hmm. And that happened over here in Belgium, where I live, in Vilvoorde, which is just 30 kilometers from my home.
Yes.
And he was graced with being strangled so that he was not burned alive, as so many. But it is recorded that his last words before the strangulation were, "O Lord, open the King of England's eyes."
Yes.
And a year later, Henry VIII permitted the printing of the Bible in the vulgar, meaning in the common language of the people.
Yes.
So we can make any discussion about if Henry VIII was a Catholic or a Protestant or whatever, that is not important.
Right.
Important is that he gave the allowance, the permission, for the Bible to be printed in the language of the common people, so that every peasant, every worker, every normal person in England at that time would be in the position to read the Word of God for himself, for the first time since more than 1,000 years of suppression of the book.
That's right.
So I just want to say that, because a lot of people will go into what you just said, whether King Henry was a Catholic or not. Let's not discuss about that. This is absolutely not important. Important is what he did. It's the same discussion that someone can have about Martin Luther. It's the same discussion that someone can have about Calvin. Every one of these protesters was a man, and every man has its mistakes. Yes. You can say about Luther whatever you want. You can say about Zwingli whatever you want, about Calvin whatever you want. You can agree with their dogmas and their teachings, or you can disagree with it. But that does not take away what they achieved for the common people, to bring the Word of God to the common people all around Europe at that time.
Yes.
So when you start criticizing this reformer or that reformer because of this that he said and you don't agree with that and that that he said and you don't agree with that, then think about the good things he accomplished first. No one of these reformers ever claimed to be a perfect person. And we have to remind ourselves, they all, like Wycliffe, like Tyndale, they all came out of the Roman Catholic Church. They were brandmarked by that, you know? They were 20, 30, 40 years in that church before they came out of it. This leaves something on your personality, whether you like it or not. You can find Jesus after that as much as you want. This leaves a mark on you. And there are some things that you just don't change in your life only because of that. But that doesn't take away anything of the wonderful achievements that these Protestant reformers achieved actually for us today. Because Tom, you and I, me, Jörg, we wouldn't be sitting here chatting over the internet and being able to make a recording of what we are doing in the history if it wasn't for the reformers that almost 500 years from now set us free from the yoke of Rome and declaring to all people to know that the Antichrist is alive and well and he sits on a throne in Rome. But please, Tom, continue. But I just had to interject that.
Yes, and I agree everything you said. And the point is well made that as imperfect as the reformers were and as imperfect as Henry VIII was, they were all swords in the hand of our Lord. And it was the translation of the Bible into the language of the people that brought the truth. And through those imperfect people, God used to bring that truth to all of us and to liberate all of us from papal tyranny. Now, having fairly well described how Protestant or how England became Protestant and how all of Europe, except for France, Spain, Portugal, and Austria and some other places, Europe itself became Protestant because of the translation of the Bible into the language of the people. Rome had lost all of her power. Rome had lost all of her influence and could no longer persecute God's people. And one of the great losses of the papacy, you know, because of the Protestant Reformation, was the loss of England. And the papacy knew that it could not regain control over Europe unless it regained control over England. And so in the middle 1860s, after a goodly time after the Protestant Reformation, the Vatican attempted to install a papal government and overthrow the government of the Queen Victoria, the Protestant Queen Victoria, and the Protestant Parliament. And he did that by first calling a Roman Catholic cardinal from England to Rome. And his name was Cardinal Wiseman. And he went, and the plot was sprung in Rome that he would return to England and read a papal bull, and then appoint 12 bishops to serve under his headship, and that they would divide England into dioceses, and then each of the 12 bishops would rule over those territories, those diocesan territories, and that would become the Roman Catholic government of England, and the Pope could declare that the reigning Queen Victoria was no queen at all, and the Protestant Parliament was no parliament at all, and just simply overthrow the government.
Interesting, the number 12 in the dioceses, right?
Yes, indeed, yes.
And another point that you made while reading that book, Rome and Civil Liberty, what I just listened today when I was on my way to the fitness studio, to the gym, you said that the cardinals are seen by the popes as their sons. Yeah. You made the link to Prince Titus, when in 70 AD, he, as the prince from the Caesar of Rome, came to destroy Jerusalem.
Right.
And now this doctor, what was his name?
Dr. Wiseman.
Dr. Wiseman was sent by the Pope, his quote-unquote father, sent to Great Britain to get Great Britain back under the crown of the Pope. He sent his cardinal, which is seen as a son in the Roman Catholic Church hierarchy. I just wanted to put that in for our listeners because I found that very interesting. Yeah.
Now,
and the number 12, of course.
Prior to the installation of Cardinal Wiseman and the breakup of the land into dioceses and the appointment of bishops over those dioceses, Roman Catholics just had to live with the Protestant government. To have any kind of peace in their lives at all, they had to bow courteously and curtsy to the Pope, or rather to the Queen, the Protestant Queen. And they were held under Protestant laws, under Parliament. But after Cardinal Wiseman returned from Rome and appointed bishops over the land, then the Roman Catholic periodicals, the Roman Catholic Church organs, as they would call them, the Roman Catholic Church newspapers, began to declare that the laws of Parliament are no laws at all, and the Queen of England is no queen at all, and now that the Pope has founded his government, we have no king but the Pope, and we have no law but Roman Catholic canon law. And so the Catholics in England and Ireland publicly refused to obey any of the civil laws of England and to overthrow the Constitution, the Crown, and the Parliament. It was just a rebellion. It was a hostile coup against the Protestant government of England. It was a forcible takeover of the government. Now, the point I want to make is this overthrow took place with the establishment of dioceses and the appointment of Roman Catholic bishops over those areas as both the spiritual rulers of the Roman Catholics, but also temporal rulers as well. In other words, they became the law, not just a church, but it became the civil law too. And that is the nature of all Roman Catholic dioceses. If they're not temporal rulers, civil rulers, as some might call it, they're not dioceses. The bishop is not a bishop unless he is both a spiritual ruler over the people and a temporal ruler as well. And it's the Pope has no power unless he can control the government, because it's the government that enforces Roman Catholic canon law. See, the Pope doesn't have his own militias to go around the world forcing governments to impose Roman Catholic canon law. He has to recruit the governments to do that themselves. And that's what was the attempt of the papacy in 1865. Was to co-opt the government, to literally take it over, proclaim himself and his cardinal, his son, as you would call him, as the ruling class, of England.
Well, let's not forget they had one militia, Tom. They always had one militia, the Regimini Militantis Ecclesiae.
Yes.
Something that we will go into a little bit later in this broadcast. So when we say the Pope has no army, no, that's right. He has no standing army like most of the countries have.
Yes.
But he has a few, quote-unquote, generals or colonels who will command all these armies for him.
Yes. So the Pope effectively initiated a coup, a hostile coup, and a takeover of the British Empire. England, Scotland, and Ireland. And James A. Wylie, in this book, Rome and Civil Liberty, is making the case before the British people exactly how the Pope installed his government, what its purpose was, the complete overthrow of the Protestant government. and then to make England forcibly Roman Catholic through the civil laws of the land, which would be Roman Catholic canon law. And that the roles would be completely reversed. The Protestants would become suppressed. The Pope would rule supreme, and Roman Catholics could persecute, as they always did before, God-fearing, Bible-believing people. Now, what I read in the previous book by Francis Rooney, The Knight of Malta, in the Global Vatican, was that the papacy controls the United States government, both foreign and domestic policy. And the question is, how did he do it? How does he do this? Well, I learned through reading this book, Rome and Civil Liberty, how he does it. And that's through his cardinals, through his sons. That's through the dioceses. That's through the local bishops that rule those dioceses. They're not just spiritual rulers over the church. They're temporal rulers as well, and not just over Roman Catholics, but everybody that lives within their diocese.
Like governors.
Like governors, yes. And the point is made in Wylie's book that even though the queen still sits on her throne and parliament still operates, there's no queen and no parliament. The real government is the diocesan bishops. So I learned through James A. Wylie's book how it is that the papacy controls the government of the United States of America and the United Nations and virtually all the other governments of the world, too. Now, the first inkling I got of this was another book that I read years ago called The Vatican Billions by Averill Manhattan. And Averill Manhattan revealed in his book that during the Dark Ages, when the Pope ruled supreme over all the kings of Europe, Roman Catholicism was the only Christian religion, so to speak. And it was a constant battle of the Pope to keep the kings of the nations under his authority. They always wanted to rebel against the Pope. There was always a wrestling match between who had more authority in the country, the king or the Pope, who lived in Rome, see? And so the papacy developed this system of dioceses where he would appoint a bishop over every square inch of the nation. And they would be civil and temporal rulers, and their main objective was to keep an eye on the civil government and to make sure that that king or queen or president, however the case may be, was always subservient to the papacy. And if that king began to rebel, then the diocesan bishops would inform the Vatican, and the Vatican would take steps to either correct that king or queen or to replace him, to take his throne away from him, take his crown off his head. When it became necessary for the Pope to overthrow a sitting government, we would call it regime change today. It's the same thing. Then the bishops were the ones who led the war against the king. And, of course, the bishop, being the spiritual and temporal ruler of all the so-called Christians, the Roman Catholics in the dioceses, well, they were the standing army against the king. They helped overthrow the king because it was the command of the Pope. And their ultimate supreme authority in their lives was the spiritual and temporal ruler of the whole world, the Pope. And so this happened all throughout history. And what was happening in 1865, according to James A. Wylie in his book, Rome and Civil Liberty, was just a repeat of what had happened so many other times previously throughout history. A forcible overthrow of a legitimate government, the unseating of a legitimate queen or king in the case of Henry VIII. And that's how they took over the government. And that's now what's very interesting to me is now that Francis Rooney has not only admitted but is boasting that the papacy has so much power over the civil government of the United States, The question was, how did he do it? Well, of course, through the civil government. Because the bishops are the watchdogs. The watchdogs over the civil power. Every square inch of this country is broken up into dioceses. They overlap the states. And it's the bishop's job to keep his eye fixed on the civil power to make sure it conforms to papal control, papal authority.
Well, Tom, instead of you saying it, how about a Roman Catholic? Let him speak. Yes. Would you like to hear what Roman Catholic Archbishop James E. Quigley told the Chicago Daily Tribune on May 5th, 1903 in that regard?
Okay, very well.
Quote, within 20 years, this country is going to rule the world. Kings and emperors will soon pass away and the democracy of the United States will take their place. When the United States rules the world, the Catholic Church will rule the world. Nothing can stand against the Church. I'd like to see the politician who would try to rule against the Church in Chicago. His reign would be short indeed. End quote.
Yes.
And I looked it up. You can find that still on the internet, the original paper. And I think I sent you an email a few days ago, Tom, if I'm not mistaken. I sent you an email with the link that you can see that and you can read that article for yourself online on the internet today.
Yes.
So it is not just we heretics, Protestants here on Hour of the Truth or on Inquisition Update telling you these things. It's the Roman Catholic Church itself that says these things.
Yeah. And the very same thing that the bishop, that the cardinal said in that piece in 1903 was the very same thing that the papacy said during the life of James Aiken Wylie in England. When Rome controls England, Rome will control the world.
And that's why Rome tried to take over England with the separation from the 13 colonies.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
This is a complete other subject. therefore, I advise every one of my listeners to go to my book reading I did with the Rulers of Evil and a few earlier broadcasts I had on Hour of the Truth where I went into the Jesuit collection into 1776. But, you know, when you take a little bit of the piece of the puzzle here from that side and from the middle and then from the other side and then from upper part and from the lower part, and then you start matching these jigsaw puzzle pieces together, a little bit of 1776, a little bit of the Jesuits, a little bit of the Vatican, a little bit of the Carols, a little bit of Protestantism, and you put this, you start putting these together, you see a picture forming before your eyes.
Yeah.
And you know, the most wonderful thing about this picture that you then see is that there is already a book written in this world that tells you everything that you will then see through the eyes of history already. And that is the Bible.
Yes.
God wrote it all beforehand. God's prophecies are nothing else than history written in advance. And it is for us, because we are today in the wonderful position in living in 2016, that we have history to look back upon. And we can confirm everything God said the last almost 6,000 years coming into fruition by putting his word next to historic facts.
Yes.
It's Isn't that wonderful?
A point well made that the papacy in 1865 tried to hostily take over England and make it Catholic again. It's enough to say, without going into great detail and time consuming, that Protestantism, for the most part, remained. And Rome's attempt to take over Great Britain failed. And so Rome just simply put all that emphasis that she put on England, she put it on the United States. And now the United States is the instrument through which the papacy intends to regain all that it lost at the time of the Protestant Reformation. All the power and authority and wealth that it lost at the time of the Protestant Reformation is now being restored to the papacy by the United States, whereas originally in 1865 the papacy intended to use England to do this. And because Protestantism prevailed largely, not entirely, but largely in England, the United States has now become the battle axe for the Pope, the conquering nation for the Pope. And that's the role that the United States plays today. The wars that the United States fights are not to preserve the independence of the United States nor its citizens. It is to preserve the rights of the Pope, not only to preserve, but to restore, and then to preserve the papacy's rights, all the rights that he enjoyed prior to the Protestant Reformation, and to make him King of Kings and Lord of Lords in all those nations, and not only that, but then to use the United States to conquer the rest of the world, where the Pope never ruled before, to conquer the rest of the world for papal domination. Mm-hmm. And there's your New World Order. Yeah. That's the New World Order. There's nothing new about it. It's just the reestablishment of the old world order. And no one needs to be doubtful or curious about who that global ruler is going to be. It's going to be the papacy, just as it was in the old world order.
Surely, and they used the Jesuits to achieve that, and the Jesuits achieved that already, because there is a very old axis all around the world that was always against Rome. And Rome has successfully today, I have to say, sorrowfully, taken away the power of that axis. That axis was Orthodox Russia, Protestant Germany, Protestant United States of America, and Protestant Great Britain.
Yes.
These four empires, because Germany was an empire, Russia was an empire, United States is an empire, and the United Kingdom was an empire at a certain time. These four powers had an axis, and power axis against Rome. And Rome, through diverse wars, and certainly the First and the Second World War of last century, was successful in setting these axis countries up against each other and let them slaughter each other. And the only gainer who came out of it today in 2016 is Rome.
Exactly.
Rome is the only one who gained by the First World War, by the Second World War, and of course by the by all the other wars afterwards. And it succeeded with that Jesuit infiltration of these Protestant countries, with communism in the USSR, overthrowing in 1917 the Tsar movement, the Tsar family, and establishing communism, and by that atheism and destroying the Orthodox Church that already split 1,000 years before from the Roman Catholic Church, setting up Russia against Germany, what is in Europe, I think, one of the root countries of the Reformation, considering Luther and the work that came out of him, and that the Luther Bible set free Germany, Netherlands, Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Switzerland, Austria at that time. The half of Europe was set free because of the Luther Bible. The Jesuits were really de-rooting the Reformation by setting up Russia against Germany, by setting up America against Germany, and by setting up England against Germany. And so English soldiers were killed, Protestant. American soldiers were killed, Protestants. Russian soldiers were killed, Orthodox. And German soldiers, Protestants, were killed. And the gainer was standing behind them, holding their coat. As you remember me reading from this book, An Understandable History of the Bible. You know, let these two lads fight, I'm gonna hold the coat. That is the Roman Catholic Church behind it. And that is something that our listeners really have to understand. Rome is so hard for many people to make out as the culprit because it stands always outside of that realm. It lets the other fight for them, and it does that with infiltration. And I think that is something that very clearly comes through when you follow a lot of the book readings that you do, Tom.
Yes, that's the same conclusion I've come to in my own independent research. The Vatican has made a perfect science out of identifying all of her most lethal enemies and then pitting them all against one another in war. That's how she conquers, by pitting all of her enemies against one another. And who are her enemies? Protestantism, mm-hmm. Protestantism, Orthodox, the Orthodox Church, and Jews. And I don't want to get into that subject because we're completely off the subject. Maybe some other time we'll have a discussion about the role that the Jews play.
Well, but they took them all on, absolutely. And truly, with the Jews, with the founding of the nation state of Israel, we were doing a broadcast more than a year ago, Tom. You probably remember about,
yes.
What was it called?
Futurism.
It was mm-hmm. the biggest lie since, the greatest lie since the Garden of Eden, the greatest yeah. deception since the Garden of Eden, where we were talking about that and the consequences of that, Satan's paradise, the second part that we were talking about that this whole world war scenario was just set up to fulfill, to build a nation state of Israel so that they can play the Jesuitical theater to implant their Antichrist that they need for their fulfillment of the already 2,000 years in the history fulfilled Daniel's 70th week, to fulfill right. their gap theory 70th week.
Yeah.
Tom, the problem is we could go on and on for hours, I think, like this.
Yes, we could.
Absolutely. But there was something that I've prepared and you too, we wanted to read for our listeners today. And I just want to say I uploaded a video on my YouTube channel, Juggler 66, last year on the 28th of July in 2015 called Ian Paisley, Rest in Peace, Teaches on the Jesuit Order. It was an audio that I found, I don't know where anymore, somewhere on the internet. And then, of course, I looked into his website, which you can do still today. It is the European Institute of Protestant Studies called www.ianpaisley.org. Is the homepage, and I will, of course, provide to you the links in the description box of this video. And there he did a preaching about 50 minutes on the Jesuit order, or 55 minutes. And I made a video of that of an hour and 13, because I made an own introduction and a little bit of obituary, because he passed away some time ago, and I wanted to get the people to know when they watched the video first who Ian Paisley was. And then I put his voice in there with my pictures, and he teaches on the Jesuit order. Now, Tom has the same problem that I have, and I'm thankful for that, that I'm not the only one who has that problem to understand Ian Paisley completely correct, because he has a dialect, of course, yeah. coming
an
from...
An Irish accent,
yeah, an accent, yeah, coming from Ireland, of course, and he is not that easy to understand, surely not for me, probably even easier for Tom, but even Tom has this problem, so I was glad to hear that I'm not the only one. Because there was a part in that broadcast that he spoke about that I had to listen over and over again to understand what it is really about. So then I took just a few words that I understood from that, and I called it the Jesuit Theology. And I looked that up on the internet, what I can find about that. And I want to read to you a little bit before Tom and I are going to doing a reading together. First of all, Ian Paisley. Tom, why don't you give a little introduction of who Ian Paisley is? And especially, I think you will mention what happened in 1984 in the European Parliament. But please give our listeners a little introduction on who Ian Paisley is, if you can.
Well, just briefly, Ian Paisley was really kind of the real power behind the Protestant Reformation in Ireland during our generation. He was the Protestant spokesman and the Protestant warrior. See, Ireland was Roman Catholic, and when Ireland was bequeathed to the government of England by the Pope years ago during King John's reign, that was the first that Protestant Christianity had ever seen in Ireland. And Ian Paisley was a, for lack of a better term, the Protestant patriarch of Ireland. And he spent his entire life teaching Protestantism and battling against the control of the papacy in Ireland. And now Ireland was eventually kind of divided in two, the northern half of Ulster, or the northern portion of it. It's not nearly half of the country, but that was under Protestant control and accepted the rulership of the Queen of England. And then the southern majority of the country remained Roman Catholic, although they were grudgingly under the Queen's control in England. They tried to maintain the Roman Catholic faith, and they were constantly at war. You know, you've heard of all the terror and battles between the northern Ireland and the south. Ireland was torn apart because the Romanists in the southern part of the country worshipped the Pope and obeyed the Pope and rebelled against the English government, which was Protestant. And Ian Paisley was a Protestant and accepted British rule. So there was civil wars constantly raging in Ireland. And Ian Paisley was the Protestant representative, the Protestant warrior for Ireland, and a great teacher. I learned so much about my Protestant faith from an Irish Protestant, Ian Paisley. And to demonstrate what Protestantism, generally speaking, and especially in this country, what Protestantism has lost, and that's the realization that the papacy is the Antichrist. You see, Protestantism was built on two foundations, one really, but two planks of that foundation. First of all, that Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. And God the Creator is the sole sovereign ruler of the universe, and that the full duty of man is to obey God and keep His commandments. But the papacy is a human counterfeit that has the same requirement of man, that every human creature be subject to the Roman pontiff. Now, Ian Paisley was the Irish voice, the Irish Protestant voice that denounced the papacy as the Antichrist of the Bible, the great counterfeit Christ. And as a representative of the European Parliament, he was, you know, authorized to go and participate in the discussions, and Parliament had invited Pope John Paul II to come and speak. Europe wanted to hear the Pope speak. You know, of course, the same thing happened here in the United States. They invited the Pope to come speak to our Parliament, the Congress. And unlike that, those days under Ian Paisley's Protestant rule, there was no protest here in the United States. They hailed the Pope as a god, or as a representative of God here in the United States, but not so when the Pope, John Paul II, came to the European Parliament. Ian Paisley was in the back of the house as John Paul II was speaking. He stood up, a worthy member of that Congress, and proclaimed, "Antichrist! Antichrist! Antichrist!" He denounced the Pope as Antichrist before the rulers of Europe. And, of course, Europe was in no mood to join the Protestant protest of the Antichrist. They were in a spirit of ecumenism, of uniting with the Roman Catholic Church and structuring all of their governments under the Pope's rulership. And so Parliament turned against Ian Paisley and ushered him out and arrested him. And would to God that there were an Ian Paisley in the world today, especially in the United States of America. But I'm afraid that even if one were faithful enough and holy enough to stand up before the American Congress and denounce Pope Francis I as the Antichrist, he would likewise have been ushered out of that house in chains. But that is the basic platform of Protestantism, that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the ultimate supreme and sovereign ruler of all heaven and earth, and that every man is subject to him. And then there is the Antichrist, the earthly counterfeit, and a very, very shabby one to start with. And Ian Paisley upheld that distinction, made sure the world understood that when they look at the papacy, they see the little horn of Daniel, the man of sin, the son of perdition. I regarded for a long time, after my investigations began, I regarded Northern England to be the only, or Northern Ireland to be the only Protestant country in the world, because it protested. And that protest was led by Ian Paisley, a true Protestant man of God.
Yeah, thank you, Tom. That was a very good explanation for that. And for the listeners, I will provide the link to the video of Ian Paisley that I uploaded last year in the description box of this video. And in the description box of that video, you can find a link where you can watch on YouTube how Ian Paisley in 1984, in the European Parliament, stood up and denounced the Pope as Antichrist with his voice and with banners that he held up at that moment, that he held up at that moment. Tom made a very interesting point here that maybe some people didn't listen to well about. He said that Jesus Christ is our King and our Lord, and the Pope claims that for himself, that every human creature has to be subject to the Roman Pontiff. Well, don't believe Tom on that. You can look that up for yourself, as in the book Rulers of Evil from Tapasauci, it is stated in the pages 37 to 38 that Pope Boniface VIII declared that France, the king, the Templars, all of them, and everybody else as well, belonged to Pontifex Maximus. Quote, "It is absolutely necessary for the salvation of every human creature to be subject to the Roman Pontiff," unquote. And you can read that even online in the papal bull Unam Sanctam. So don't take my word for it. Don't take Tom's word for it. Read it for yourself, and we give you even the sources where you can read that. But to continue on that Ian Paisley thing that I've listened to. So he was speaking about the Jesuit theology. And when I looked that up, I first found a little paper that I'm going to read a little bit to you, and then Tom and I will read an article from something else. That's later. So the Jesuit theology here. Father Herman Buchanbaum, a leading Jesuit, in his book on moral theology, a book that is esteemed by the Jesuits to be an unsurpassable work and used in all their Jesuit colleges, says, quote, "Permission to murder all offenders of mankind and the true faith, as well as enemies of the Society of Jesus, is freely given," unquote. Paul Comitello, an Italian Jesuit, who states in his book on morals, quote, "It is allowable to kill an illegal aggressor, even if he be general, prince, or king, as innocence has more value than the life of a fellow creature, and a ruler who maltreats the citizens ought to be annihilated as a wild, cruel beast." And then we have Martin Beacon, a Jesuit, who in his book on morals states, quote, "Every subject may kill his prince when the latter has taken possession of the throne as a usurper. And history teaches, in fact, that in all nations those who kill such tyrants are treated with greatest honor. But even when the ruler is not a usurper, but a prince who has by right come to the throne, he may be killed as soon as he oppresses his subjects with improper taxation, sells the judicial offices, and issues ordinances in a tyrannical manner for his own particular benefit. And then we find Bishop Wordsworth, Anglican clergyman and theologian for some years in the Bishop of Lincoln, uncovered the secrets of the Jesuits in his exposé of a most important Jesuit document used in the early days of the Jesuit order to compel Protestants to submit to the Holy Mother Church of Rome. All Protestant converts were forced to swear this oath. And I'm not going to read this oath to you right now, because I did a little bit more research on this, and while I did research on this, I came across a paper that you can find online that is called The Christian Guardian and Church of England Magazine. And on page 177 of this, The Christian Guardian, Church of England Magazine, published in 1830, I will going to read a little bit, and Tom will interrupt me with the word comment if he finds it appropriate to make a comment, which I hope he will do. Tom, you still there? Listening?
I'm here.
Okay. You have anything to say to that before
yes,
I start?
I would just tell you that the Jesuit priests that you quoted from their own works mm-hmm. are literally restatements of ancient jurists and doctors in the Roman Catholic Church. And I'll name some: Thomas Aquinas and Alfonso Liguori and Robert Bellarmine.
Oh, yeah.
So these Jesuit priests that you quoted are simply parroting the words of prior authorities, Roman Catholic canon lawyers. They call them doctors in the Roman Catholic Church. But that's long been the doctrine of the Roman Catholic Church, that it is not only legal, but it is a meritorious work to kill a heretic king. In other words, one that's not Roman Catholic. Okay? So it's a doctrine of the Roman Catholic Church that heretical kings, rulers, can be overthrown at the Pope's command. And it's no sin to do so. It's no rebellion to do so. It's a meritorious work, according to the Roman Catholic Church. So every government is vulnerable if it has Roman Catholics within it.
Mm.
And if that government rebels against the papacy. That is the sword that every king on this earth has over his head, that the papacy can overthrow him, that Roman Catholics can overthrow them and actually achieve ecclesiastical or spiritual benefit from. Okay, back to you.
Okay, thank you. What you actually said, Tom, is just a confirmation of what we all know, that there is nothing new under the sun. It's always just another person who comes out with the same stuff and maybe puts it in a few little different words, but the idea is still the same. And that the ideas of Rome are not new is known to everybody who studies that subject a little bit, because everybody knows who studies that a little bit that Rome is just the same of the ancient Babylon. It is like a red wire that goes from Babylon all through history to Rome today. It's all connected. So what they first introduced in Babylon, when they introduced that in Rome today, it is not new. It is not introduced. It's just a warm-up of the same stuff. And that's history, you know. There's not so many things new under the sun. But okay, I'm going to read to you a little bit from this Christian Guardian magazine from 1830. And the article is called Popery in Hungary. Sir, the accompanying important document so clearly demonstrates the unchanged and unchangeable spirit of the Romish Church, wherever she is dominant, that I am induced to transmit it to your journal, in the hope that the perusal of it, with the divine blessing, may arouse slumbering Protestants to stand fast in the glorious liberty of the gospel wherewith Christ has made them free. Well, Tom, no comment? Slumbering Protestants?
Yes, slumbering Protestants. Protestants love their peace, and if anybody disturbs their peace, like the Pope, they would rather just stay asleep and ignore the threat from Rome. But Rome will eventually wake them up when they are subject to Roman tyranny again. Then they will protest again. And the papacy simply wears out the saints. And during a time of peace, the Protestants put down their guard. And that's the opportunity the papacy always uses and catches the Protestants asleep. Mm. So,
I've read somewhere, Tom, that somebody said, I don't know where and when I read that, it's a long time ago, but somebody said that every generation again has to fight for the freedoms the generation before achieved, or exactly. They will be lost.
Yep.
And that is something that the people today just don't understand. And when we see our children rising, the next generation, and these children getting children, and we are receiving our first grandchildren in that way, that is why there is so much change through the generations, because the historical teaching is not taught anymore. We have forgotten to uphold the rights that we are given into our cradle like it was nothing. We never achieved anything. We never tried. We never had to do anything to achieve these rights. They were given to us with birth, and then we forgot about it. And then it is very easy to take them away. If not every generation again and again and again fights for the rights it has inherited from the generation before, these will perish. And I think the very best example, a very pitiful, a very sad example to make, is what happened to the Protestants in the United States of America over the generations.
Yep.
What spirit of Protestantism is there today compared to 300 years ago?
You can almost plot this on a graph, Yerk. Whenever there is a rise in Protestantism, there is a rise in civil liberties. Wherever Protestantism is in the ascendancy, so is personal liberty. On the converse, every time there is a rise in popery, there is also a rise in tyranny. You can plot it on a graph. And the reason that we are losing our liberties in the United States and the rest of the world is because popery is in the ascendancy and Protestantism is asleep. The hope of the world over this new world order headed by the papacy is the rise of Protestantism. That's our only hope. And what makes Protestantism powerful enough to overthrow that papal tyranny? It becomes fervently instructed in the scriptures. Protestantism is just another way of saying scriptural literacy. Whenever the Bible is embraced by the people, Protestantism is in the ascendancy and liberties are in the ascendancy. Whenever the Bible falls out of favor, then Protestantism is in the decline and so are personal liberties. You can plot it on a graph. Back to you.
Okay. So I will continue reading in the article. This confession of faith, as it is termed, was drawn up by the Jesuits and is imposed upon converts to popery in Hungary at the time of their public renunciation of the Protestant faith. It was translated for and appeared in the record of February 4, 1830 by the Reverend J.C. Reichardt, one of the missionaries of the London Society for Promoting Christianity Among the Jews from the Urania of the Reverend J.W. Deek, published at Berlin in 1829. Having been favored with the loan of the rare and curious volume in which this confession is contained, I have collated the letter with the German, so that your readers may depend on the accuracy of the translation and judge for themselves of the detestable tenets which Protestants who embrace Romanism in Hungary are compelled to profess. Now, just a little note from me here. The author says that he has collated the letter with the German. so there must be a German original of this, and I spent hours researching on the internet, and I couldn't find the German original from this. So I'm very sorry to say that that was a fruitless research. So I'm gonna translate that into German myself. I'm already halfway through. So, yeah. Yes, Tom, you have a comment?
Yes, I would like to prepare your listeners for what they're about to hear.
Oh, yeah.
Of your listeners are going to find this very, very shocking. Okay? This is a statement of faith that is imposed upon Protestants who have renounced their Protestantism and are now joining the Roman Catholic Church. This is what they must profess to become Roman Catholics. And you need from now on to listen very, very carefully to what is read and what is stated about these articles of confession. This is what it takes to become an obedient subject of the Roman Pontiff. And it's shocking. All right, Jörg, I hope I prepared your listeners for what they're about to hear.
Yeah, I think, Tom, it is even appropriate to say that what I am going to read right now is as important to know as to know the Jesuit oath of induction. Right, huh? Okay. The Romish Confession of Faith imposed on proselytes to popery in Hungary. First, we believe and confess that under the peculiar care of our high authorities, both spiritual and civil, we have, by the diligence and aid of the Reverend Fathers of the Jesuits, been brought from the heretical way and faith to the true Roman Catholic and saving one, and that we have embraced the same voluntarily and without any compulsion. We now make our public confessions to the world with our mouth and with our tongue. Well, I first have to make a comment here already, because if you believe that any real Protestant would ever, without any compulsion, would make this statement freely, I think you are very wrong. But I don't think that we have the time to go into everything the Inquisition stands for. But just remember, I want to remind my listeners of what the Inquisition stood for. Remember the song that you were listening to in the beginning of this broadcast? Remember the pictures that I've showed you of inquisitorial apparatus that was used to torture the people? When you get through a torture like this, I think you will even confess something what is stated here now under point 2. Quote, we confess and believe that the Pope of Rome is the head of the Church and that he cannot err. 3. We confess and believe that the Pope of Rome is the representative of Christ and has full power to forgive and to retain sin arbitrarily and to cast into hell and to excommunicate whomsoever he pleases. 4. We confess that every new thing instituted by the Pope, whether it be contained in the Scriptures or not, whatsoever he has commanded, is true, divine, and saving, which the common man has to value more than the commandments of the living God. 5. We confess that the Most Holy Pope is to be honored by everyone with divine honor and with the profoundest reverence, just as it is due to the Lord Christ himself. 6. We confess and maintain that the Pope is to be heard by all men in all things as a most holy father. Hence, such heretics as life contrary to this institutions shall not only without any exception and without any mercy be destroyed by fire, but also be cast into hell, both body and soul. 7. We confess that the reading of the Holy Scriptures is the cause of all corruptions and sects, and the fountain of blasphemy. 8. We confess that the invocation of dead saints, worshipping their holy images, bending the knee before them, going to them in processions, clothing them, and lightning tapes for them is holy, useful, and saving. 10. We confess that saying Mass for the dead, almsgiving, and praying is profitable and saving. 9. We confess that every priest is even greater than the Mother of God, Mary herself, inasmuch as she brought forth the Lord Christ only once and brings him forth no more. But a Roman priest sacrifices and creates the Lord Christ not only once, but whenever he pleases. Yea, and after having created him, he swallows him entirely. That was, of course, the communion. The, what's it called? The Eucharist, right?
Roman Catholic Mass.
Yeah, the Roman Catholic Mass. Okay, there was a mix-up with the points. I'm continuing now with point number 11. We confess that the Pope at Rome has power to alter the Holy Scriptures and to add and diminish as he pleases. Okay, a little comment of me. As we can read in Revelation, whoever takes away or adds to the book, he will feel the whole wrath of God. So, you know what he's awaiting, right? Point number 12. We confess that souls are, after death, purified in purgatory, and that the sacrifices of the Mass by the priests afford them help to their deliverance. 13. We confess that receiving the sacrament in one kind is good and saving, but in two kinds is heretical and damnable, or condemnable. 14. We confess and believe that those who receive the Holy Sacrament in one kind receive the whole Christ with body and blood, with his Godhead and his bones, though they use and eat the mere bread. 15. We confess that there are seven true and real sacraments. 16. We confess that God is worshipped in images and that through them people know God. 17. We confess that angels and men must esteem the Holy Virgin Mary higher than Christ the Son of God. 18. We confess that the Holy Virgin Mary is Queen of Heaven, who governs together with the Son, and according to whose will the Son must do all. 19. We confess that the bones of saints have great virtue in themselves, on account of which they must be worshipped by men, and chapels must be built for them. 20. We confess that the Roman faith is the Catholic one, is unadulterate, divine, saving, primitive, and true, but that the evangelical, that is, the Protestant, which we have voluntarily renounced, is false, erroneous, blasphemous, cursed, heretical, pernicious, seditious, wicked, fictitious, and invented. As therefore the Roman religion, as of one kind, is thoroughly and perfect good and saving, we curse all those who have introduced to us this opposing and wicked heresy of two kinds. We curse our parents, who brought us up to this heretical faith. We curse likewise those who made the Roman Catholic faith doubtful and suspicious to us, and we curse those who administered to us the cursed cup. Yea, we curse ourselves, and call us cursed, because we made ourselves partakers of this cursed heretical cup, out of which it is not lawful to drink. 21. We confess that the Holy Scriptures are imperfect and a dead letter without the explanation of the Pope at Rome and his permission to read them. 22. We confess that one Mass of a Roman priest for a soul is of much more use than 100 and more evangelical sermons. And hence we curse all those books which we have read, and in which the heretical and blasphemous doctrine is contained. We curse likewise all our own works which we have done whilst living in this heretical faith, lest peradventure we might merit anything by them at the last judgment before God. All this we do with an upright mind, and confirm by a public renunciation of the heretical doctrine in the presence of the Reverend Father, in the presence of the very learned gentlemen, of the venerable matrons, of the young men and young women, that the Roman Church in these similar articles is the true one. Moreover, we swear that as long as we live, we will never any more turn again to this heretical doctrine of two kinds, even if we should not be under any restraint. We also swear that so long as we have a drop of blood in our body, we will persecute this cursed evangelical doctrine and eradicate it secretly and publicly, violently and deceitfully, with words and with deeds, the sword not excluded. Finally, we swear, before God, before the holy angels, and before you here present, that in case of a change in church or state, we will never, either from fear or complaisance, depart from this saving Roman Catholic and divine church, nor turn again to or embrace the cursed evangelical heresy. This completes the 23 quotes. The article continues a little bit further on, but I think that is something that we can skip for today, and I would like to have Tom to make a little comment on the points that I've just read.
Well, I would just like to ask your listeners, have they ever heard in their lives or imagined in their hearts greater blasphemies than you just heard? That is the oath that a prospective Roman Catholic must swear to enter the Roman Catholic Church. This is how Rome forces those under her sway, those under her coercion, those under her authority. And stop and think a moment what we've been speaking about prior to reading this, that the government of the United States is admitted by a Knight of Malta, Francis Rooney, in his book, The Global Vatican, that the Vatican, the papacy, rules over our government. This is the oath that every proselyte into the Roman Catholic Church from Protestantism must swear. Think of the look. It's easy to imagine in one's mind that once we have tasted grace, once we have tasted the sweetness of Jesus Christ, no one who had ever been a Protestant could swear these things. Not to mention the Bible tells us not to swear at all.
Yeah, very important point, by the way.
Yes.
Very important point, because when you read Rulers of Evil, that will be made very, very clear when you read chapter 24, The Mark of Cain, that you can ask yourself, well, when the Bible says you are not to swear, how can you swear that you will hold up office?
Yeah.
How can you live under a president of the United States of America who is sworn into an office when the Bible says, do not swear?
Yes.
There is already the beginning of the blasphemy, right?
Exactly.
And people just don't see that. I tell you, I've learned so much from reading Rulers of Evil. It's incredible. I'm looking forward to reading it a second time, because when you read it once, you learn something. But I think when you read it twice, you learn even more. But
you learn something from that book each time you read it. I mean, There's no way we can understand the volume and the scope of that book just through one or even several readings. It's a very important, a very deep, and a very detailed book, and there's much to learn in that book. But I think the point should be very obvious to your listeners that no Protestant would profess these things unless under coercion.
That's why I said in the beginning, remember the torture apparatus that was shown in the video before, in the song, you know, the torture song that I play in the beginning of this broadcast.
Right.
And for that, just turn to the book that is mentioned in that song. I show the picture of that. It's called Acts and Monuments, but most people know that book under the title Fox's Book of Martyrs. If you ever thought of reading Stephen King or something to get a little bit horror in your life, I tell you, just read Fox's Book of Martyrs and you will get more horror than you can bear for the rest of your life, and you don't need any fiction like Stephen King or whatever. The reality is much more scaring than the fiction can ever be.
Certainly, and if any of your listeners are shocked to the point of disbelief over what we've just read, all they have to do is read Fox's Book of Martyrs. And then you'll be persuaded that this oath that we just read here is a perfect illustration of the historical Roman Catholic Church. And this is no fabrication. This is no late fabrication. This is no Protestant heretic spewing some falsehoods to calumniate the Roman Catholic Church. This is history. It's history that's been hidden from us. Because Rome had every intention to do in this country what she attempted to do in Britain in 1865. And if this information were extant, and it was still read in the Protestant churches, if it was still taught in the schools, if it was still taught and talked about in the press, if it was still taught and talked about in the churches, Rome couldn't achieve what she's done, either in the United States or Europe or the rest of the world. The people of the world would see the Roman Catholic Church for the horror it is, and universally rebel against it and condemn it and destroy it.
Yeah, absolutely right, Tom. You know, the article goes a little bit further than just what I've read, but I think that is something for another broadcast. Yeah. And also because it relates to what was taught at the Council of Trent.
Yes.
And the anathemas that are very well known, that were spoken out at the end of the Council of Trent. And when you look at the anathemas of the Council of Trent and the 23 points of the vow that I've just read here, you will see much that is alike in there, much yes. that you will find back. And that is proof that this is not just another Protestant invention or whatever.
Yeah.
But we have been busy for more than an hour, Tom, and I think it was quite a little bit for our listeners to cope with. It was quite interesting, I hope. I'm very much looking forward to make a second part of that with you. So I want to thank you for your contribution today on this broadcast on Hour of the Truth meets Inquisition Update, what I'm very grateful for that we can do that. And I will upload these on all three YouTube channels as usually. But Tom, do you have some closing remarks for our listeners before I close down?
Yes, it's customary for me to close with a salutation that the Lord brought up in my heart to help correct the error, to expose the greatest deception since the Garden of Eden. How can I convey, in brief, the basic information that will correct the error of apostate Protestantism? And it's modeled after the lie called futurism that is taught by the Roman Catholic Church. And it goes like this. Blessings in the name of the one who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease 2,000 years ago. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, the Savior of the world, the true King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Thanks for having me, Jörg, and good evening and goodbye to your listeners. I'll see you next time.
Yeah, see you next time, Tom. Thank you very much for your comments and your explanation on Global Vatican reading, on the reading of Rome and Civil Liberty. And I just want to make my listeners attend to the point that you can go to the website Firstamendmentradio and listen daily to Tom's broadcast on Rome and Civil Liberty, where he not only reads but explains, dissects, and really puts apart the book of James Edgar Wylie, Rome and Civil Liberty. Thank you very much for your attention today. Thank you very much for listening and watching. And hope to see you back next time with another Hour of the Truth meets Inquisition Update. Until then, God bless you all and bye-bye.